Welcome to Virtual Book Signing. I'm Daniel Weinberg, and as usual, here we are at the Abraham Lincoln Bookshop in Chicago. And we welcome you at this Thursday evening for another session. We do this, of course, every month, and we welcome you to be with us all the time and be virtually with us. Of course, we ask you if you have a question during the show and you'd like to ask that of one of our authors or both, please email in. Give us your name and where you're from so we can shout out to you and say hello, and we'll try to get it on the show as well. If you're on the archive, you won't be able to email in questions, but you might still be able to get a first edition signed book and put it on your shelf. We appreciate all of you being with us and supporting us, and our publishers bring authors to us because of you supporting book sales through this independent bookshop. So today we have two wonderful authors, as we always do. And first we have John Waugh, former reporter and bureau chief at the Christian Science Monitor. He's the author of 11 books on the Civil War era, including The Class of 1846 from West Point to Appomattox, Lincoln and McClellan, The Troubled Relationship, Reelecting Lincoln, The Battle for the 1864 Presidency. And he's also co-author, editor of a book, How Historians Work. His latest book, Lincoln in War's End. It's a Southern Illinois University Press, part of the concise Lincoln Library that you're probably all familiar with at this point. It's 132 pages, right in the area it's supposed to be, illustrated, and it's $24.95. Also with us is Scott Martelle. He's the editorial writer for the Los Angeles Times, the author of The Admiral and the Ambassador, Detroit, a Biography, The Fear Within, Spies, Commies, and American Democracy on Trial, Blood Passion, The Ludlow Massacre and the Class War in American West. His latest book, The Madman and the Assassin, The Strange Life of Boston Corbett, the Man Who Killed John Wilkes Booth. 226 pages illustrated, and it's $24.95. You know, we should be mad, I suppose, at Boston Corbett, because we could have used a little bit more of Booth for us, because we may be the only place in the solar system that was not totally unhappy with what Booth did, because I don't think there'd be an Abraham Lincoln bookshop without martyrdom. That's a different story.
Kind of a dark way of looking at it, but I can see the logic.
Here we are. So, though the central character of your book, Scott, is Boston Corbett, there's a wealth of stories surrounding him in here as well. Right. So it puts him in his place and has wonderful stories around it, which is really the journalist in you, I think. How did you come to this subject in the first place?
By accident.
Because we're at the right time for it, of course.
Yeah, and it was a bit of a sprint to get it done.
Yes.
My last book was about the guy who went to find John Paul Jones's body, a guy named Horace Porter, who should be familiar to a lot of your viewers. He was an aide to General Grant and the follow Grant to the White House. He also, in the McKinley administration, became ambassador to France, and through that wound up finding Jones's body. I finished with that project, that was through Chicago Review Press also, was looking around for another idea and kept hitting dry wells. And so my editor at Chicago Review Press, Jerry Poland, emailed me, and he knew I was scratching around, says, have you ever heard of Boston Corbett?
Who was here, by the way?
Who was over here.
To make sure you were doing
off
your
camera.
Job.
Hello, Jerry. He's here to correct any factual errors, right? He hasn't ever heard of Boston Corbett. And I said, no, I haven't. And he emailed back, well, he castrated himself and killed John Wilkes Booth. And for a journalist, it's like, okay, I can work with that.
You didn't bury the lead either.
No. In fact, the first chapter of the book is about the killing of Booth. And in typical newspaper standard, we get the body in the lead.
Yeah. So. Well, it's a terrific book about someone most people don't know anything about. Right. A minor character that had a big effect and was lost to history, really, in a way. Talking about history, John, how do historians work? I was interested in your in that co-editing work of yours. How do historians work?
Well, they all work differently.
I mean, they sit in an ivory tower, have their research assistants do all the research, and then maybe they'll write it up real fast and reap the royalties. Am I wrong?
Well, I talked to a couple of historians, one of who works in his skivvies, and the other who writes in the nude. So it's quite a different operation depending on the historian.
I'm always dressed when I work, just for the record.
Yeah, well, I am disheveled. I mean, I'm either in dress or not in dress. You know?
Right.
Either way, what historians are trying to do is tell a great story and tell it factually and tell it so people will enjoy reading it. That's what all of us try to do. And no matter how we get there, how we take notes or whatever, we're trying to get to that place where we have written a book of factual history, but have written it in a way that people want to read.
That's in people's minds, perhaps, that's a change, because most people see or have in their past had dry books in the past, excellent works that have great information, but not well written, especially.
Yeah,
and now it seems that that's changed.
Yeah, and I think sometimes historians, particularly academic historians, don't give writing equal time with the research. And I think that's a mistake. I think we really have to give time to the writing, because it is so important in getting the message across. You might as well not write if you don't.
Perhaps we should make every historian become a journalist first.
Well, actually, if I could just add to that, if you think about the way we, most of us, communicate with each other, it's through storytelling. Yeah, we don't just sit there and recite a bunch of facts, right? So that's sort of the foundational way of how we relate our experiences to each other.
Yeah.
And so many historians lose sight of the power of the narrative.
Yeah, if you want me to give a definition of history, it's drama. And it's a great bunch of stories, and it's got to be told that way. And whenever it's told that way or written that way, people love it. You know, a lot of people say, I didn't like history in school.
Yeah, exactly.
Had it been told as a story, they would have been hooked for life.
Yeah, very true.
As we are.
Yeah, I think we're all of the age where when we were taking history in elementary and secondary school, it was dates and great men.
Yeah.
Right. It wasn't the stories that tied them together in the narrative arcs of their lives.
Yeah.
But I think all that's changing. I think more and more history is becoming stories. At least the historians are writing it that way.
Yeah, people like Jill Lepore, or learned, accomplished historians who are also best-selling authors.
Yeah. Yeah. David McCulloch and Alan Gelzo, and there's a whole group of them now. And it's kind of an exciting time, I think, in historical writing.
Yeah, definitely a great time in Lincoln Studies.
Corbett, let's get to his character a little bit. It was fascinating reading your book about it. One of his fellow soldiers said he was a good speaker and knew no fear. And, of course, he was a fanatic in religion. Tell us a bit about the character he was.
All of that in more and in a deeper level.
You have 22 seconds.
Yeah, okay. Probably the best way to summarize this is after he had his religious epiphany, he was following the teachings of a woman named Phoebe Palmer, sort of this mystic Methodism. And he got it in his head. I'm not a person of faith myself, but I admire that he was able to at least try to do this. He got it in his head that if he could live each minute, each hour, each day in a Christ-like manner, then he could lead the perfect Christian existence.
Mm-hmm.
And that just powered pretty much everything he did. And it was that sort of that devotion to his religious beliefs that I think really made him stand out.
Yet for that, I mean, that was off-putting to numbers of people.
Oh, yeah. He was considered a freak. I mean, somebody would swear, he'd drop to his knees and utter a prayer. You know, so he was pretty insufferable.
Yet he had some friends for life, and he made friends as he went along.
Right. And the close friends that he maintained tended to be people who had that faith in common, that extreme faith in common.
Really, is that what it was?
Yes, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you read the letters, some of these are available online now through the Kansas State Historical Society, letters to Corbett, almost all of them contain some sort of biblical reference, religious reference, either to a biblical passage or to some sermon or something that Corbett had given that this person had been at.
So how did he become a marksman?
I don't really know.
Really?
I don't really know. I mean, so much of his early life is unknown. He was somebody with no public persona until he killed Booth. Mm-hmm. So I don't know where he got his marksmanship skills. He grew up in a city in New York. So I really don't know where he learned how to shoot.
Fascinating. Yeah.
Well, he was also, he had maybe the friendship part or maybe the religious part. He had good nursing skills for going to hospitals and helping fellow soldiers right. who are in there, friends. And at one point, I love this pregnant moment, as you mention it, of Lincoln and Corbett actually meeting in a hospital and shaking hands.
Yeah.
But he was...
I don't think it was the hospital, it was the church, I think.
Was it the church? Yeah. I thought I remember the hospital.
Yeah, it was just as after the 12th New York State Militia got to Washington during the okay. first call-up, and everybody was bivouacked everywhere,
right.
and the 12th Militia was in a church for a okay. short time. I think that's where...
But he was very good in the hospital.
Oh, he was.
He spent a lot of time there?
Convalescing, and while he was convalescing, he was holding prayer sessions, and he'd played the same role in Andersonville. He spent about 5 months in the Andersonville prison, and he was noted during that time for leading evening prayer sessions, and if you're an evangelist, you can't find a better place to recruit souls than a place like Andersonville, right?
Right,
desperation.
Well, Gene from Champaign, Illinois. Thank you, Gene, for this. He's getting down to almost my last question first, so let's go right to it, John. It's for you. What is the most important thing you would like readers to take away after reading your book?
Well, I think the way I got into this book originally was I wrote a book on Lincoln's re-election campaign. And then the Southern Illinois University Press started doing these concise Lincoln Library books. And they brought in a whole stable of historians to write these different aspects of Lincoln's life. And when I came to it, they asked me what I would like to do. And I said, aha, I did Lincoln re-election, which stopped at the re-election time. And then this would be an opportunity to take and tell the rest of the story. So that's what I did. And meanwhile, I've lost track of your question. So what was it again?
So have I. I've been on to the next one for heaven's sakes. The question was, what is the most important, Gene wanted to know, what the most important thing to take away from your book after reading it?
Well, I think they need to take away the majesty of what Lincoln was trying to do. Mm. And, it was a time when he got the 13th Amendment passed, which freed all the slaves. Was a time when he delivered that second inaugural, which was one of the great speeches in the English language. It was a time when he went for the last 16 days of the war and spent it with Grant, and actually working with Grant in that hotel to wind that up, and which finally wound up with Appomattox. But also, and he went to Richmond and walked the streets of Richmond the day after it fell. Now all that is drama. That is great drama. That's what I'd like to see people come out of that and say, boy, this is a great story.
Oh, it is a great story. Yeah. And of course, strangely enough, I'm going to give a plug for SIU that all of these concise Lincoln books are interesting stories in themselves, small but fascinating. I'm going to show here, this is the last image of Lincoln from the flesh, from life, I could say, too, although he's in his coffin in New York City. And it's interesting, another Lincoln-Corbett connection, because Corbett was headquartered in City Hall in New York, yes? When he got there just for the draft riots.
Right,
a little bit late for that, but that's just where this was, where his body was lying in state. So he came at the draft, I'm kind of skipping ahead a moment here, but because I wanted to show this, basically.
Right.
But he came in right after the draft riots were beginning to settle down, am I right?
Right, yeah. They deployed the unit back to New York City, but by the time they got there, pretty much all the violence was over. So it was kind of, a cleanup and continue to maintain order kind of thing. And they were nearing the end of their term also.
Your 3 month term?
Yeah.
So. Well, tell us about, let's get into a little bit of what Corbett, how he got into the war through the 12th Militia in New York.
He was working as a silk hat finisher for a guy named Brown. And Brown was a member of the 12th New York State Militia. And when the call went out, when Lincoln sent out the call for 75,000 troops, you guys probably know this better than me, 75,000 troops for a 3 month call up. Brown wasn't feeling very well, and he was afraid of leaving his business, unled, uncaptained. So he paid, as you guys are aware, you could buy your way out of the service. So he paid Corbett to take his place in the 12th New York State Militia.
Well, where did he serve with the militia?
Corbett. Yeah. They went to Maryland and then to D.C. and then wound up over by Harper's Ferry, where they were just thumped and they're all taken captive and then released, paroled.
So during that time, he was doing what before the captivity in those months?
They weren't really doing much. But the only real action they saw was the action they received as they were losing Harper's Ferry. I couldn't find any good records of the 12th New York State Militia on what they were doing. Through the vagaries of record keeping back then, it was state militia records. The state doesn't have them. The National Archives doesn't have them. So who knows where they are?
Look in your attic.
Yeah, somebody's got them.
Yeah, someone's got them. You know, John asked you a question before, where did you become a marksman? Well, I'm going to ask, where did you become a horseman? It was odd when I was reading the book, and all of a sudden he was 12th, and then all of a sudden he was in the 16th New York Cavalry.
Right.
Well, I didn't know him as a horseman before that, in the pages before. How did he get into the cavalry?
I have no idea. If I knew the answers to those questions, this would be a slightly longer book.
Yeah.
But the problem is, like I said before, is there's so much that just wasn't recorded about Corbett.
You have to do a second book.
Exactly. The unanswered questions. But in that era, you know, there's a lot of, even in New York City, there's a lot of horses around. So I presume it was just part of the culture at that point. The marksmanship, though, I mean, you wouldn't think you'd learn that in New York City, even in the 1850s. But you never know.
Yeah, exactly. It wasn't that difficult to get out of town then. And
you could
probably get
right
into the rural area
right
pretty quickly. And,
yeah,
and we don't know much about him, as you say. But he was a hatter, as you say.
Yeah, silk hat finisher.
Silk hat finisher. You say that that's maybe the essence, because he went into a lunatic asylum later. We'll get to that later on. But looking back on that, is that the definition of a mad hatter? And did mercury poisoning contribute to that?
Yeah. The phrase Mad Hatter came from that whole process. They used mercury mixed in with water and some other things as a compound to form the felt for the hats. And as they worked, that compound, it became aerated, you know, whatever that word is, aerosol, into the air. Mm-hmm. And so they're inhaling all this stuff at a time when nobody knew what effect mercury had, you know, the horrible effects mercury has on the brain. But people, I think this began in England, realized that these hat makers over time started becoming psychologically unbalanced. And so the phrase came up mad as a hatter. And then they finally figured out that, you know, the madness came from the mercury poisoning.
Hatters weren't the only ones who was getting poisoning by chemicals. Photography world at that time.
It was pretty common.
All the chemicals that they were infusing into themselves, and they became maybe not mad, but quite ill.
Yeah.
You mentioned the second inaugural, John, and I guess got to go back to that. You devote a chapter to it, which it deserves.
Yes.
So what makes it so special, the second inaugural?
Well,
in case someone else doesn't know about that.
Well, it very succinctly lays out what this war was all about, and it's so beautifully written. It is really, I think somebody said, some British said, among the three greatest statements or speeches or talks in the English language, two were from by Lincoln, and that was the Gettysburg Address and his second inaugural. It's such beautiful writing. I mean, somebody asked me once, if Lincoln came back, what would you ask him? And I would ask him, how did you become such a great writer? Because that's what I am.
That's genius, is it not?
Yeah, it really
maybe
is.
Maybe his genius.
The genius, but he was able to write something so succinctly and so on the mark that it's just beautiful stuff. And, you know, maybe his storytelling had something to do with that. That's always getting to the point. And I think that he was able to get to the point and to get a difficult situation stated in a very eloquent manner. And,
well, he read a lot, of course, and he read, Shakespeare went to the same grammar school, I don't know,
because
we don't know where either of them got
their
right.
Well, he read Shakespeare, and there's no more beautiful writing in English language than Shakespeare. But boy, these two speeches by Lincoln rank way up there.
Almost best read out loud than read. You know, to actually
Yeah.
I suggest people taking it and reading it out loud, right. So you have
two
ways to listen to it and think about it.
Yes, you can feel the cadence of the language.
That's right, exactly.
And Lincoln himself said when he liked to read out loud because it gets into two senses.
Exactly.
And I think that's a very good way to go about it.
Dan. Talking about the election of 64 and into this period, did Europe remark on the election and also that second inaugural? Did they take note of, first of all, a president and a democracy being elected during a civil war, election going on, and then that second inaugural being produced? Did they remark upon this?
Oh, yes. Yeah, some of the press that was well-informed or knew good writing, they were very complimentary about it. And you know, when he first came in and after 1860, they all believed that this guy was illiterate and was not going to measure up. And I think by 1864, when he was reelected, I think they began to see the genius of Abraham Lincoln, not only the political genius, but the writing genius of the man. So I think that's it was quite a switch over from where it was at the beginning.
Mm. Scott, we've been talking a little bit about Corbett and his religious views. He was part of the Great Awakening.
Right.
What was that, and how did he fit in?
This is one of my shallow knowledge areas. I only
researched. You know, you're a chapter ahead of us, so you're right ahead.
It was sort of this reconnection and resurgence of different faiths. There were like several different eras in which this happened. That there were three great reawakenings over time, and it was a very cyclical kind of thing, and it was very fundamental. This is where prayer meetings came to the fore. They referred to the upstate New York area as the burned over area because of all the hellfire and damnation stuff. But that's where the Mormon Church began, the Seventh Day Adventists. You know, a lot of churches began, through that wellspring. But there are also a lot of churches that came out and just flopped. One guy and four followers that went nowhere. So it's just kind of a fascinating era, and that was the crucible in which Corbett was forged.
Well, you talk about his eccentric expressions of faith, quote unquote. What were those, and how did castration get into that? There's a non-pregnant question.
Well, he had, by the accounts that I was reading, he had a fairly high voice. He was a very small, slender man. Had a kind of a high voice, and during the prayer meetings, the Fulton Street prayer meetings, if somebody would say something in a prayer or in a sermon that he thought was particularly compelling, he'd just holler out in that high voice of his, glory to God, amen, glory to God, to the point where he became known among the other faithful as a glory to God man. They're the ones who gave him that nickname. And several of these prayer meetings disinvited him from coming to the meetings because he was so exuberant and over the top.
Mm-hmm.
He also had a bizarre way of speaking. He'd throw different syllables at the end of words, like I can't even do the imitation, but it was just a bizarre kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So which really made him stand out. But the self-castration made him stand out even more.
Like that.
Yeah. He had married and his wife had died. He became an alcoholic, fell in the bottom of a whiskey barrel, got saved by some early versions of Salvation Army type folks. They wrapped him up, cleaned him up, sobered him up. And that began sort of his religious awakening and epiphany. There's no record of him being a faithful person before that.
Mm-hmm.
He could have been, but there's no record that shows it. But we know he was at that point. But he was still a young man, and he had sexual urges. And friends said that he felt that his libido was getting in the way of his street preaching. So he took a pair of scissors one day and castrated himself.
Mm-hmm.
And then, and then went to dinner, and then went to a prayer meeting, and then went home and thought, maybe I ought to see a doctor.
Hmm.
And he spent the next 30 days or so in Massachusetts General Hospital.
Hmm. Did he talk about it at all afterward?
I haven't seen nothing from him that I've seen.
Hmm.
And in the affidavits and statements you get from people that knew him then, they weren't specific about that scene. I mean, people talked about it earlier that he had said that that's what had happened. But it almost sounded like he didn't really talk about it much over time. Everybody knew it, but nobody says, Corbett told me yesterday.
And the hospital records? Nothing there, or can you find them?
Well, there's There's some, but it's kind of quirky. It almost looks like somebody had gone back after the fact. This is in the Rodzinski file collection at the Lincoln Collection in Illinois.
Okay.
It's available online. Lincoln Foundation Collection, I think it is.
Yes.
It's handwritten, and it's, you know, very old writing. This looks like a logbook. Mm-hmm. And it's got, you know, dates. You know, Corbett came in, he had done this, and the medical descriptions of how they sewed him up and all this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But at the top, it says, this is Boston Corbett, the man who killed John Wilkes Booth. But, yeah, Corbett castrated himself in 1858. Yeah. He was still Thomas Corbett at that point. He got baptized a couple of months later and assumed the name Boston then. His thinking was that Jesus renamed his apostles, so he renamed himself for the place where he got baptized. So it looks like somebody had gone ahead. Well,
that's fair, I think.
Sure, sure.
Although Connecticut felt differently, but that's a different story. I wanted to ask about the slavery views of Boston. Did that come from his religious views, or did he have that even before, although the record is so thin?
Yeah.
But where did that arise from, do you think?
I really don't know. It's one of the many unknowns. Mm-hmm. There's a story I couldn't verify, that he, when his wife died, she died on a ship at sea. They're going from Richmond back to New York. He'd been working as a sort of an itinerant hat maker for the time they were married. They're in Troy, New York, and other places. And one of the stories is that he had been run out of Richmond because he kept, you know, talking anti-slavery stuff in Virginia and not doing it politely. And so he got run out of the city. But I see nothing that could verify that, so I didn't put that in the book.
You give first of all, a gripping account of the escape of Booth, the trying to be escape of Booth. And it's really wonderful. It just, you know, kind of flows along. You feel you're right out there with him. But he was greatly disappointed, I think, in the South's reaction to him when he saw newspapers that were brought to him, was he not?
He was, yeah. He thought that the South would welcome him as the avenging hero. Mm. And, you know, the war was over at that point. There were still some troops out there, but for the most part, the war was over. And a lot of people didn't view it as, you know, a heroic act. They thought it was cowardly, you know, because they've laid down the weapons, so, you know, why assassinate him now? So it was problematic. I mean, there was a lot of articles. There was some support for him, but there were a lot of articles condemning him. And some, you know, leading, I forget which one specifically now, but some other leading Confederate figures were condemning the act.
Did he get the support from the South as he went through Maryland to escape? Did he get support among those people as he went? Did he really feel he can get away?
He when he left, he felt he could get away. I don't know what his thinking was by the time I caught up with him. But he had some support. You know, there was kind of a smuggling operation that had been operating during the war, and he tapped into some of those people, John Surratt, people like that. And so they helped him, but some wouldn't. There was one woman, her name's in the book, I forget it at the top of my bins of the queue, who wouldn't let him in her house, but, you know, she just referred him to someone that she knew would help him, so it wasn't like, you know, pushing him away, but also not, you know, really, you know, sheltering him at a time when he needed it.
You know, at the Garrett farm, right. It's kind of an interesting thing, his mental state. I should say not the Garrett farm, but before that, to chase him, to try to find Booth, is what I meant. What was his mental state regarding the assassination? Because he was asked, as a religious man, he wouldn't do anything on Sunday, on the Sabbath, yet you write about they asked for volunteers to go out and try to find Booth, and it was the Sabbath, boom, he was right there,
yeah.
And went out. That's how strongly he felt about the assassination?
Right.
Is that what you're...
I think so. I think, you know, he spent most of the war in the Union Army. There was only a few months where he was, you know, a civilian. He signed up or continued his enrollment 4 different times. So he was, like, fully vested in it. And I think, like, you know, anybody who was supporting the Union at that point was just aghast and shocked when Lincoln was killed.
You know, there was a very strong feeling in the South among many people that that's the worst thing that could have happened to the South, is to have Lincoln assassinated. So, you know, maybe this wasn't universal, but I think with a lot of the leaders who understood what was going on, they really felt that's the worst thing that could have happened, to lose him. And I think they suffered from it because of it. And
well,
they knew they would.
You know, I'm asked, and I'm sure you and others are certainly asked by people, if Lincoln had lived, what would have happened? Would have been different, Reconstruction different? Well, it's a pure speculation, but I'm going to ask you to speculate. What's your feel on that as speculation, even though
I think it would have been quite different and quite
better. And lasting?
Pardon?
And lasting as well, do you think?
Well, I think so. Lincoln was a very astute politician. Johnson wasn't. And I think that Lincoln's abilities and his capabilities of trying to get where he needed to get, despite all the opposition of the radicals, I think that his political skills and his heart would have taken him to a place where it would have been entirely different, that it would have been a more helpful and benevolent kind of thing, because he just wanted to get everybody pardoned,
yeah.
Get them back, get the country back the way it should be, slavery gone, and he would have done that in a very kind, benevolent fashion. There wouldn't have been in him the hatred that I think he would have been able to disarm a lot of that hatred,
mm-hmm.
simply because of the kind of man he was. So yes, I think it would have been different. I don't know how different,
yeah.
But I think at the same time, it would have been much more benevolent, would have been more caring, more forgiving, and I think that would be all of the good. I think it would have given a different
result. Of course, the radicals were strong, and
yeah.
they outlasted any administration. He had a few
yeah.
more years, but after that, and there's speculation, I'm not going to go there,
yeah.
what would have happened with Lincoln's benevolence if when he was out and the next guy comes in and the radicals
yeah.
take over and who knows what.
You can't tell about that. You know?
No, we'll never
that
know
was one of
that.
His concerns about the Emancipation Proclamation, that somebody else comes in, they could do away with it. So,
which is why it was such a bill of lading.
Yeah, that's right. But a very, very legal document. And then, you know, that's why he wanted the 13th Amendment passed. So it was set in concrete what he wanted to do.
Scott, what are a couple of the, you know, there's conspiracy theories that came up after Booth's death at Corbett's hand. And what were some of the conspiracy theories that came up surrounding him and that death? Was he the first Jack Ruby?
Perhaps. one of the big conspiracy theories was that Booth wasn't killed. It was somebody else.
Yeah.
Booth and Harold were traveling under some fake names. I think it was the Boyd brothers. And so this conspiracy theory got running around that it was some guy named Boyd that got killed. It wasn't Booth. Even though Harold says, yes, that's Booth. And he had the initials in the hand. And the leg was broken in the right place. And he was a famous face. And all these people saw the face and says, yes, that's Booth. That conspiracy theory still survived. Another one was that Corbett was the one who did the shooting. It was actually Conger, one of the detectives, who was along for the ride. And that persists to this day. There was an article, an interview piece with me, I think in the Kansas City Star a few days ago, posted online. And somebody at the bottom puts in the comments, no, Corbett didn't kill Booth, it was Conger.
Yeah.
yeah. 150 years later, yeah, that thing's still percolating around out there.
Sure.
So.
Well, when I first came into the business, there was a guy who called me every 2-3 months because there was a mummy that came out of Enid, Oklahoma,
right.
where a later day or someone who called himself John Corbett, Boston Corbett, lived for a little or
little
went
bit.
Through.
His wife was through there. Yeah.
yeah, but that's where the mummy came out of.
Right.
So I thought, oh, I was thinking conspiracy there.
Yeah.
But
well, like that, you know,
they were
Oklahoma.
Asking where the mummy went because it came to Chicago on display and then it was, poof, it was gone. We
yeah.
don't know where it
yeah.
is.
Yeah. That's like that Enid is involved in two of those conspiracy theories, you know, the Booth, the fake Booth and the fake Corbett. You know?
Yeah, yeah, which I kind of like.
Yeah.
The reward money was interesting. That's an interesting story, is it not?
Yeah, yeah.
And that got very convoluted, and it took time for that to percolate down, and no one got, or very few got what they thought they'd get.
Right.
Conger, by the way, was, I think, more than going along on the ride. I mean, I once had the photographs that would have gone on a reward poster, but these were in an envelope, a War Department envelope, and Adjutant Conger's name was on that. And inside were the photographs for him to identify Davy Harold and Booth,
right.
and also Surratt if he was around.
Right.
And so he was really right there. Of course, it was between him and the head of the 16th Cavalry, who really was in charge, and that also played into the reward money.
Well, that was the question. That was the problem. Is Baker, was it Colonel? The uncle, the Correct. Private detective.
Yes.
He had summoned his nephew, Baker, and Conger, or Conger, if you pronounce it. And he was going to say this information, the two guys who may have been Booth and Harold had crossed the river in Virginia. So he had that information. Then he summoned Doherty. Lieutenant Doherty told him to put together a squad of 24 men to go with the two detectives to run down this thing. So there was no clear, you know, command from Baker to actually who was in charge of this thing. And Doherty, because it was a military mission, assumed he was. And the two detectives, because they're working for the guy who's in charge of the search, presume they were.
Yeah.
And they worked together well as a team, except for Conger, he had some health issues. But they worked together well as a team during their part of the hunt. And when they came back, and you know, several days later, several weeks later, when the money became an issue, you know, all the stories changed. It's kind of interesting if you read the original affidavits from when they were debriefed on the Montauk
mm-hmm.
to the stuff they were writing, you know, 3 months, 4 months later.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a little shift in exactly who did what, and you know, so it's fascinating. And like you said, very convoluted.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. How much reward money finally came out?
Oh, if you can tell me, there's going to be specific questions.
I should have put it down myself.
I think it was $75,000. There were several different ones. Right. Yeah, there was some for Jefferson Davis. I mean, they had a bunch of rewards posted
right.
out. And I think for Booth and Harold, it was $75,000.
Let's keep this general.
Well, we'll get to a general right here. The taking of Richmond. I was a bit surprised on page 75 to read that when Richmond was taken, Lincoln said, "Now the nightmare is over."
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'd always thought that Lincoln believed the war ended when the enemy's army was taken. That's what he's always going for. Forget Richmond, go get Lee, go get the others. And at that time, when Richmond was taken, there were Confederate armies, three of them, in the field still. So I was kind of surprised to hear him say that when it was really the armies he was after.
Yeah, but you know, by that time it was apparent that Lee was doomed, and because the campaign was on, Petersburg had fallen, Richmond had fallen. Those were clear signs that this was the end. You know, the other armies out in the field, there wasn't one in the West because Hood and his army had just disappeared. But those armies out in the other areas didn't really matter. When Lee surrendered, that would have been it, and he was about to surrender. Lincoln knew that, and when he left City Point and went back to Washington, he knew it was about over, and the next day it was. They signed the Appomattox, and the war basically was over in his mind, and I think that's why he said that then.
Lincoln and Tad, his son, of course, went into Richmond. Did they become the first Civil War tourists?
No, there have been others there before who'd gone. Reporters were in there before he came.
Mm-hmm.
And when he landed and started walking toward Davis's house, several reporters were among the crowd, and they were writing about that later. But that boy was one of the most dramatic passages in American history.
And you write about it wonderfully in here.
Oh, it's such great drama.
It is.
And I get back to the drama of the past. It's just fabulous. To have a president, a sitting president, go in, the city was still burning.
Yeah.
And to walk through the streets with all these black people realizing who it was and saying, "Lincoln have come, Lincoln have come," and following him and shouting and huzzaing, and the Messiah had arrived. What a scene. I mean, what a dramatic scene. And then he went up into when he finally reached Davis's house, he sat in his chair and sort of had this dreamy, faraway expression on his face.
That chair went to Gideon Wells, by the way.
Did it really?
Yeah. He was a collector, and he got one of the desks out of Appomattox. There were three desks there.
Really?
He got one of them that's basically not well known.
He had good connections.
And he had good connections.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
If I could just jump in briefly on the Civil War tourism thing.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Remember the first Battle of Bull Run. All the day picnickers had come up from Washington to watch the quick work that the Union guys were going to make of the.
Well, that was almost pre-tourism.
That's true.
That's entertainment.
That was voyeurism. Voyeurism.
And actually, the reporters were working, right?
Yeah.
So they weren't tourists either. I think Lincoln and Tad. I'm going to go with
that's
my guy.
You can say that.
Yeah. I can say that. Now, talking about the general, General Weitzel yes. was with him there in Richmond. And you give, did Weitzel give insight? Lincoln met with the highest ranking Confederate still left there, yeah. the Assistant Secretary of War, John Campbell. And Weitzel was in the room with them. Did he give any insight into Lincoln's demeanor and how that went when here he was surrendering his city in a way to
Lincoln?
You
know, that's a good question. I don't know. I have not seen anything on Weitzel. Got into to what Lincoln looked like and what he was acting like. But, you know, I'm sure that he certainly was right on the inside of that thing. And, of course, Lincoln later came back and said to undo what he actually had done in trying to set that up.
I'm going to show two things here. This is going to be a little difficult, but I'm going to do it. Boston Corbett. I'm going to ask about life after celebrity, because he became one.
Yep.
And I want to ask what it was like, because here he is with a card, and I've seen that here and there, where he is given... People have asked him for his autograph, and here is one that obviously he gave to someone. And then here is a playbill, a facsimile of the playbill that the doorkeeper of the house there went and had this printed up.
At Ford's Theater.
Exactly. Here is Buckingham, by the way. I want to show what he looks like. Someone actually put onto the back of this one Buckingham's photograph, which is really kind of nice. By the way, any of our artifacts that you see can be available to you if you'd like. So I would suggest if you really have an interest in one of these, you can actually call us. So there's Buckingham, and there is the playbill that he was showing. So for the question finally, did Boston Corbett cash in on his celebrity?
No. He made himself available for like the GAR would have reunions and that sort of thing, and they would pay his way to go to those events. His presence was requested at a lot of public speaking engagements, that kind of thing. He might do it for like $4 or $5, but he didn't really try to cash in on it. So in fact, after he left Washington, he went back to making silk hats and preaching.
But then he went out to Kansas. He made his way out to Kansas. What brought him out there?
He was starving in Camden, New Jersey. So he couldn't make a living. Fashions changed. People weren't buying silk hats anymore. There was a recession in the 1870s. He was a kind of a self-created preacher. He had a permit, a certificate from the Methodist Church to run a little mission church, chapel church in Camden. But that was really just the living room of his house. So he couldn't make a living, couldn't make any money.
He seemed to be crankier when he got there, though, no?
Well, yeah, I mean, he was sick. I mean, really sick. You know, dysentery, chronic rheumatism, scurvy, you know. One of his legs, he had to appear that he was really in bad shape. They'd come together and help him out sometimes. And in this case, it was a guy who had met him through one of the GAR sessions, a local assemblyman, got him a patronage job as an assistant doorkeeper at the state legislature, Topeka, in Topeka. And so Corbett left his 80-acre homestead where he failed as a farmer. He's a New York City kid, right? He went to Kansas to be a farmer. Mm. And he had an 80-acre homestead claim that had gone unclaimed and quickly figured out why, because it was pretty much untillable land. Mm-hmm. It was somewhat useful as a pasture, but he wasn't any better as a sheep raiser than he was as a farmer. So he was starving again. A guy named Knapp got him appointed. So he left the farm behind in the hands of a neighbor that he had hired, and went to the state capitol, and there he got in trouble.
Well, he got in trouble. How did he get in trouble?
When he got there, he was in a pretty good mood. By being the doorkeeper, he was allowed. He's essentially sort of an usher, but he's allowed to carry his gun and his knife. Mm-hmm. And when he got there, he was in a pretty good mood, you know, talked with people. He was sort of an object of curiosity. People come to the capitol just to see Boston Corbett. And then he went through one of his cycles and started getting paranoid, thought people were laughing at him, telling jokes about him. And one morning, the legislature wasn't in session for the day, but the Capitol was full of people, you know, doing their lobbying and bribing, whatever you do in a Capitol before the session starts.
Or today,
right. And Corbett heard a couple of the janitors who he had befriended. One of them told a joke, and they all started laughing. And he thought they were joking about him. So he pulled his gun out. And, two or three of them saw the gun and took off. And the one guy who was his friend you know, didn't, you know, why are you running? And it's like, you don't see the ghost behind you, right? He turns and sees Corbett with a gun, then he starts running. And they went through several hours of standoff before the marshals were finally able to get the drop on him, snuck up on him. Took him to jail. He was went to court the next day, one day insanity hearing, in which he made two mistakes. One, he defended himself, and two, he went on the stand. And had this long soliloquy about all the people who were trying to take his property. It was a conspiracy. Secret societies. Booth belonged to a secret society. They're sending threatening letters. They're burning his land.
That didn't help his defense.
Yeah, right to the Topeka State Insane Asylum.
So. Yeah. How long was he there?
A year. Just about a year. Yeah.
And then he was let out finally? And
no.
No.
In that era, the managers of these places lived on the grounds. Mm-hmm. And so the manager of the insane asylum had a kid like 10 or 11. And Corbett and some of the other inmates were out for an exercise thing one day with the orderlies. Mm-hmm. And a friend comes up on a little pony to visit the manager's kid. The parade keeps going. Corbett slows down, smells a few more flowers than the other guys. Mm-hmm. The parade went beyond him. He took off with the pony, untied it, hopped on, disappeared. Showed up a couple, 3 days later at a friend's house, another Andersonville survivor in southeast Kansas. And told his friend to tell the folks in Topeka where the horse is. And then a couple of days later, he got in a train saying he's going to Mexico and disappears from history.
Mm-hmm. Until your book.
Yeah, yeah, I brought him back.
There's an artist named Boddicker with this beautiful print. We've shown this before, but I got to do it again. Otto Boddicker. And he was really America's most consummate 19th century military lithographer. And this is an 1865 Cerrone hand-colored lithograph of him in front of Savannah, which was the Christmas gift, of course,
right,
to Lincoln. After the burning of Atlanta, which was also General Poe was the one who did that, the orders from Sherman. But was he really Attila when he went from his march to the sea? Was he really like Attila as we hear from the South?
No, I don't think so. You know, it was, of course, it appeared to the Southerners that he was, but, you know, he...
And he still is alive today.
Yeah.
That he pillaged and whatever.
Yeah, well, he had that reputation in the South of being, you know, this Attila. And Sheridan also had that, the ultimate Attila thing.
Yeah.
But, the Southerners felt that way, but... you know, this is something Sherman felt he had to do to end this war. And, you know, he said right along, you guys stop fighting us and I'll do anything for you. And basically, that's the way he felt. You know, he had taught school before the war began down in Louisiana. So he liked the Southerners, but he had to win this war. And so he had to be that way. He realized that he had to make people suffer in this thing. And
the burning of Atlanta, though, before that, where he got a reputation, wasn't there part of it, though, the Confederates also burning part of that?
Oh, yeah.
So it's not just on Sherman.
Right. You always have that speculation. Had that speculation in Columbia. Had that speculation in a lot of places that... Did the Union Army start the fires, or did the Confederates start the fires?
Mm-hmm.
And some of those questions have not been resolved to this day.
You talk about, I'm switching around here in these last months, but you're talking about Fort McAllister. And I thought about that because the guns were pointing in the wrong direction, right?
Yes,
it was
right.
Like Lawrence of Arabia at Aqaba, right? Is this the same thing?
Yeah. Well, that often, you know, when you start expecting the enemy to come from the sea, and they start coming from the land, I mean, that happened a couple of times, not just at McAllister, but, you know, that's kind of a surprise. And, you know, you've got to turn these things around and make it for that. But that happened several times in that war.
I have a Marine Corps commission that I just got a couple of weeks ago that unfortunately I had to send to a book fair in New York. But it's for a Marine, and there are only 93 Marine officers during the war. And this is for a guy named Ramsey, who actually was the head of the Marine Band at Gettysburg during the Gettysburg Address, and also turned out to be at Fort Fisher, and raised the flag after Fort Fisher fell. He raised the flag. I just thought about in Iraq, wasn't it, Tikrit? I just heard today that a commander tries to go into an ISIS-held building and raise the flag, except while he was ready to do that, the building blew up on him. They had booby-trapped the thing. It didn't happen to Ramsey, but what was the importance of Fort Fisher for him?
Well, you know, the sole port that was still left open that the Confederates could get supplies, and this was the only one still open. All the major ones had closed. And to take Fort Fisher, close that off to them, and the stranglehold was definitely on at that point. And it was critical for that reason. It really was the culmination of the blockade, mm-hmm. and they shut down the Confederacy. And that the idea was that would certainly hurry the surrender, and it did. It had a great effect. And then they finally took Wilmington itself.
I also wanted to get your impression of you mentioned Hood before.
Yes.
Hood took over command from Johnston. What do you think about that?
Oh. Hood was very rash. You know, he would want to fight, and although I think it had the same result, if Johnson had not been replaced by Hood, Atlanta would still have fallen. But Hood was a fighter. He believed he had sort of a heedless fighter, and I think that the reputation he had for that was borne out in all that.
Mm-hmm.
And when he went up to Franklin, you know, he made these multiple charges at Franklin. That was heedless, you know. That wasn't thinking.
Mm.
And I think that Johnson was really a thinking general, a defensive general. Hood was a very rash, offensive-minded general. And at that particular point, that didn't work.
Mm.
You know, Hood's stuff just didn't work. It didn't work at Atlanta, it didn't work in Franklin, it didn't work at Nashville.
Didn't work at Little Bighorn either.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
But it, you know, there was a peace conference in Spielberg's film and also in your book. And was that conference that was taken on because of Blair and Seward, basically, I think, to appease the peace Democrats? Is that what that was really about? And also importantly, did Lincoln, going to this peace conference, tacitly undermine his stance of not recognizing the Confederacy, even though it wasn't him and Davis, yeah. but still, he was there at a peace conference.
Well, I think he was trying to put a quietus on all this peace talk. He knew that they weren't going to come to a peace agreement because Davis was demanding independence. Lincoln was demanding a reunited country, and they were not going to move, either one of them.
Yeah, there's not a compromise space between those two positions, is there?
There's no compromise, and Lincoln knew this. I think Davis knew it.
Yes.
And but they came together, and I think there was something to that he wanted to. He was conscious of the drive on the Democrats' part to try and end this war that way, but still he knew it was fruitless. But I think one of the things, he wanted to show the country that it was fruitless.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was...
Well, how about Davis? I mean, he was not particularly for that peace conference either, I don't think.
No, he wasn't. He
so heard. Why was he pushed into it?
Well, I think that he had the same kind of pressure.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Southerners wanted this war over too.
Yeah.
And I think he had the same kind of pressure, basically, that Lincoln did on the other side.
Well, I'm going to give you some things to do here for a few moments.
We haven't been doing anything so far.
Yeah. Real work. The other one says this is play. This is real work.
This is physical labor.
Yeah, physical labor and selling books.
So we need to sign this, Jerry.
Well, I want to, first of all, just thank a few of the people who have done this. We can't do all of you, but a few of them. Certainly Rob in South Perth, Australia. Frank and Turner, Oregon. Harold in Pottsville, Pennsylvania. Rob in Holt, Michigan. Eugene in Champaign. Thank you, Eugene, for your interesting question. Dan in Beaver Dam, we always say hello, and I'm going to say hello again. Harold in Pottsville, Pennsylvania. Garrett in Lancaster, California. Darla in Sacramento, California.